Good morning to everybody. As you can see from this slide, that we will see today quantitative methodology for risk assessment in financial products. The main idea of what we are going to see today is how an investment decision takes, its form. In other words, when an investor has a take an investment decision, usually he follows a sequential filtering procedure. Maybe that he does not know, but this is exactly what he does. The first thing is the first question is for how many years he can renounce, to his liquidity. So in other words, for how, when you put your money into, for example, a bond or a stocks or structured bonds, it's not obvious the fact that you can get your money back immediately. Not only due to the fact that that there are some costs that you will undertake when you will take this investment, when you do this investment, but also because there is the volatility within the markets, and so the kind of financial products that you have bought, maybe in 1 week, 2 weeks, or 2 months, whatever, this product loses its value, its initial value, and so you cannot disinvest and get your money back. So, in a certain sense, it's important that you monitor this aspect immediately in order to understand that you solve the first problem for this decision, that is the investment time horizon. Okay? As you can see in this slide, under this decision, you will reduce this first filter will reduce the number of products that can be, under your possibility of investment. Then there is the second question. The second question is, what is the overall risk that you want to undertake in this decision, that you are able to tolerate? And usually it is quite well diffused, a qualitative approach. In other words, a medium risk, a high risk, a low risk. This is such that, typical approach that in this process of investment is involved. The third one is the return. In other words, once you have filtered the products in terms of investment time horizon and degree of risk, obviously you will choose what? The products that is more efficient. So with the same risk and time horizon, you will choose the product that will give you the higher return. Seen in this way, it seems an easy task. The point is that, unfortunately, these three dimensions are not deterministic. Because there is the market uncertainty, the risks, and so it's not easy to identify what is the optimal time horizon, what is the effective degree of risk of the product, and what is more important, what is the potential return of the product over the investment time horizon. It means that these considerations led to the need of developing some quantitative procedures in order to quantify, you know, in order to identify these three dimensions in a proper way to allow you to take an informed investment decision. Okay? So this qualitative information will be in this class redefined in a quantitative way by using probability theory in order to give you three pillars, three, you know, main references that you could use as a retail investor or also an institutional investor in order to decide what product you have to buy. Let's start with the first pillar, that is the unbundling, the price unbundling, and the probabilistic performance scenarios. In order to understand this first pillar, we take four financial products. These four products are definitely different, not only for their names, because we have a defaultable bond, a low-risk bond, a VPPI product that is a structured product, variance proportional portfolio insurance, so it's a product where financial engineering rearrange over time the bond and the equity components in order to leave the degree of risk more or less stable over time, okay? And then there is an index-linked certificate that is a sort of derivative, a securitized derivative, okay? So, with all this information about names, I don't think that you can take a decision, an investment decision. Maybe that I would, if I would add, a fifth product, for example, a structured debt bond, you know, those structured bonds that engineers life insurance products, in particular, you know, the life components, maybe that your investment decision would be immediately to discharge the death bond because the name actually is not nice, okay? So what I want to say is that you cannot take any kind of decision just by looking at the name of this product, because you don't know nothing. By making a further investigation, in any case, you realize that, for example, a defaultable bond by interest rate volatility in terms of risk, you know, sources of risks. A significant exposure to credit risk. A low-risk bond has a limited exposure to credit risk, for example, a German treasury bond. But there is also interest rate volatility there, as also for the VPPI product, because a product that, you know, balances equity and bond component obviously is hit by a volatility of the interest rate and structure. But thanks to this financial engineering, it has a limited exposure to market risk. As regards the index-linked certificate, you have the other way around, a significant exposure to market risk. Also, with this further piece of information, you will agree with me that it's not enough. You have just a qualitative list of the risks that hit the structure of the products, but you still don't have any clue about what are the, you know, potential returns of these products. What it is needed to do? Let's take, for example, an index-linked certificate. We know that this product has a complex financial engineering, has a several derivative components that are embedded in the structure. We have several sources of risk. But in order to go through the features of this product, we need to apply the fundamental theorem of asset pricing. This is the common basis that, in order to price and hedge in the world of hedge risk, in the world of financial markets. What this theorem just states under, an intuitive point of view? It states that the fair value of any financial products is just the expected discounted future payoff. What does it mean concretely? It means that we have, for example, a possible trajectory that would describe the value of the product that starts here. And ends there at the fifth year. Or you can have, for example, another trajectory, the blue line, or another, the green line, or another, the purple line, and so on. And by building this picture, and then by making the average of this probability distribution and discount, you get the fair value. So this is the full picture of the product in terms of risk assessment. That is the concrete application of the fundamental theorem of asset pricing. So in other words, you have to project the future possible value of this product, build the probability distribution, and then by computing the expectation and discount, you have the fair value. Okay. When you have a similar picture, you immediately realize that, and here in this slide you have a full picture of the application of the fundamental theorem of asset pricing for all the four financial products that we have described before, you realize that what is a fair price? What is the fair value of this product? In nothing more than a weighted average. It's nothing more than the first moment discounted of that probability distribution. So in other words, when you buy a product, you pay the fair value, that fair value is just the first moment of the probability discounted of the probability distribution at the expiry date of that product. What are the possible value of the product in the future? I give to any possible trajectory the proper probability. And then by using this information and the corresponding sigma algebra, you compute the fair value of the product. But if the fair value is a weighted average and is the first moment of the probability distribution, the expiry date is also weighted average. The problem is, in your opinion, how much information is conveyed to the retail investors just with the first moment of a probability distribution? That is the point. Because, when you have a probability distribution that is definitely, different one each other, that there's plenty of kurtosis, skewness, how can you rely on just the first moment to take an informed decision? So, is it correct that when somebody sells you a financial product, they just give you the price? Is the question. The answer obviously is no. because the price does not represent the risks. Or better, it's just the first moment of a probability difference. And usually the first moment, it's definitely a poor piece of information in order to decide how to invest. I will now make you a small provocation. If these four products would be engineered in order to have the same fair value, because, you know, I will define the structures of these products in order to have, yes, they have different probability distribution, but the weighted average discounted gives you the same value. How, in this case, you will take your informed decision just by knowing the name of the products, the sources of risk, and the price. It is clear that is, you know, like a blind man that has to find, you know, the key of his apartment. No way. So what I want to state is that intuitively is not the price, the piece of information that can allow you to move in the complex world of the investment decision. In order to be more formal and to give a substance to the intuition that I shared with you so far, let me just recover some other kind of consideration. Why the first moment is not enough? Because actually it is clear that we have to understand the statistical properties of the probability distribution embedded in that financial product. Because, for example, for the defaultable bond, we have a bimodal distribution. For the, let's say, low-risk bond, you have just, you know, one peak for the distribution, and according to the kind of volatility of the interest rate term structure, you have more or less kurtosis, you know? As well as for the VPPI products, you see how the distribution is asymmetric and has a plenty of kurtosis there, has a very fat tail, you know, on the positive skew of the shape of the distribution. And for the index-linked certificate, the presence of different derivative components implies that you have multimodality also with skewness and kurtosis. So in a certain sense, the statistical properties of the probability distribution actually gives you the information you need in order to explore concretely the features and the risks of these financial products. By going back to the first moment analysis, in other words, the fair value analysis, we can say that for a product like this one, a low-risk bond, maybe that the price should convey you some information. Because the price is the average of a distribution that is, you know, quite symmetric, that has no kurtosis, yes, a little bit of dispersion. So, forget about moving with the price with similar other distribution and products. So, the price and the corresponding weighted average at the expiry date, actually, for the largest part of financial products, qualify a partial and misleading information. In order to make a step, you know, beyond with respect to this consideration, let me recall the method of moments. It's a statistical technique that allows you to to compute how many moments you need in order to reconstruct a probability distribution. So you have a probability distribution with a certain shape. How many moments is needed in order to, you know, depict that probability distribution that I have defined by using, for example, some Monte Carlo simulation, as we have done before when we have applied the fundamental theorem of asset pricing. We use this formula that is related, that relies on the Christoffel function of degree k. This is the technicalities. But what is relevant for this class is that in order to reconstruct a defaultable bond, in other words, a bond that has two modes, we need 16 moments. So the price is the first moment, but in order to reconstruct the entire picture, you need to convey to retail investors 16 moments in terms of pieces of information. So usually they sell you the product with one instead of giving you 16. And in this case, we are speaking about, you know, an interaction between the bank and the investor that obviously has as a counterparty a statistical investor. So a subject that is able to read this piece of information and use the 16 moments conveyed during this selling procedure in order to reconstruct the probability distribution. In other words, it's an exercise, since I do not believe that my mother that uses to teach philosophy will be able to reconstruct with 16 moments the probability distribution of the defaultable bond by using, you know, the Christoffel function. Also for a low-risk bond, you know, with the two moments, you have the red line, so it's a quite good reconstruction, but the a better representation of this distribution requires four moments. So also with a product that is quite simple, a product that is only exposed to interest rate volatility term structure, you need four moments in order to understand, to reconstruct coherently the probability distribution. You can imagine what happens for the other products. For the VPPI, you need 12 moments. And for the index-linked certificate, you need 20 moments in order to rebuild these probabilities. So, the information content of the first moment is very, very, very limited. So we make the promised step beyond. Now it's not only the intuition that supports what I said about the fact that the first moment is not able to help you in investment decision, but now you have also some statistical, you know, background that support this conclusion. Are there any questions so far? Everything is clear? Well, so let's try to move in another dimension. In the dimension of the return. Because I know that an investor is definitely more familiar with the absolute figure. I invest 100 euro, I get back 3 years from now 200 euro. Actually, the investor is not used in computing a compound interest of its investment because we are used, you know, to play with money in a rough way, let's say. I go into, you know, a coffee bar and I take coffee, I pay 1 euro. I make an investment, I give 100, and if I receive 120 euro next year I'm glad, if I receive back 80 euro, maybe that I am not very happy. But in any case, in financial markets, we are used to play with return. Actually, internal rate of return for investment, that is that value that solves a simple, you know, optimization procedure, nothing more than that. So the average annual return that close the information between the price at the moment of investment and the potential final value of the investment at the expiry date. Also the internal rate of return, that is the alter ego of the fair value, in a certain sense, is in any case a first moment. Is an average. Is nothing that gives you information about risks. It just tells you if you invest 100 in this product, in average, you will receive 2% per year. But we don't know if you can lose 5% the first year, 10 in the second, in the third. So the realized return is definitely something that is not, you know, necessarily equal with the average return that is represented by this piece of information. In fact, if we change the perspective and we reproject the probability distribution of absolute values in terms of return, it does not change nothing. The probability distribution remains the same because it's just a rescale procedure. Instead of putting absolute value, you move from 100 euro to 160 euro with respect to 100 euro original invested, you just rescale with respect of the original investment by using some easy, you know, financial mathematics formulas, and then you compute the internal rate of return. Again, for a low-risk bond, this internal rate of return conveys you some information like the price, and maybe that if I tell you, you buy a govies that gives you 3% return, and I tell you in words that there is no default risk, with respect to another govies that gives you 2.5% of return without default risk, obviously this is an exercise in the market, you will never find a similar investment opportunity, it is here that you will choose the bond that gives you 3% of return. Because since there is no default risk, the product, obviously, the first is more efficient than the second one. But when you move with a product like this one, it is clear that the internal rate of return just gives you, you know, an average between the two modes of the distribution. The two pieces of the distribution. Unfortunately, the one on the right-hand side or left side, according to the perspective, is related to the default of the bond. In other words, you invest 100, but unfortunately, the entity defaulted, then you get back 40, between 40 and 60. If this problem will not appear, no default, you will receive all the coupons and also your money back. And so the product will give you a result between 100 and 140. But as you can see, the internal rate of return just tries to give you a way in the middle between the two pieces of the distribution. And actually is definitely misleading. And it's the same thing for the VPPI product, where the internal rate of return try to capture the incredible courtesies of the product that can give you 300 euro back with respect to 100 euro invested, so a very long fat tail in the positive return space, but obviously cannot capture this feature, just give you a weighted average of all this information. And for the trimodal index-linked certificate, if you think that an internal rate of return of 5% means that in average we'll receive back 129 over 100 invested, you can imagine how much this information can be completely misleading, since there are a plenty of probability where you can also receive back zero. But if I give you just that piece of information, what you will see? That the index linked certificate is the most efficient product, because it gives you almost 6% of average return with respect to the 4 of the DPPI and 3 of the defaultable bond. But this is not correct. This is not the picture, the full picture of the product. So, how can we make in this complex world a step beyond? Once it is clear that with complex structure, forget about interest rate of return. We have to find a compromise with respect to the need of an investor. We have to give an information that is easy to understand. Why the internal rate of return or the final value of your investment are information that are usually given to the investor? Because they are something that you can digest. I would say, look, you give me 100 euro, in average, in 5 years from now, I will give you 130 euros. It's something that you manage. Or I will give you 3% per year. It's something that you manage. So that is something that we have to realize. It's important to find some quantitative metrics that are easy to understand. The second, I cannot accept as a quant that the information that I give you does not capture efficiently all the statistical feature of the problem. That could be a big mistake, as we have seen in the previous slides. An easy proposal could be, I just give you the entire distribution. Yes, it could be a solution, but let me tell you something about. First point, remember that these are, we are speaking about quantitative methods applied to finance. So in other words, there is the model risk. According to the model that you use, you can have the same fair value, but unfortunately some small differences in the probability distribution at the expiry date. Is a model dependent, the probability representation of the product? So in other words, for example, for a defaultable bond, if you use another white model or a Cox-Ingersoll-Ross model in order to model the interest rate term structure and its volatility, you will see that the picture will be different. And so it would arrive the problem, what is the correct distribution? You know, it's not there is not the best solution. And the model risk is something that you have to manage when you are, for example, in the bank you know, from the other side. You price or you work in the risk management function of the bank. You have to manage this issue. So, if you see, for example, also for a BPPI product, by using an Eston model for market risk or a normal inverse Gaussian model for the market risk, it's a different picture. And the picture is different also for the trimodal index linked certificate, where we have calibrated the product with the mercantile diffusion model with respect to the variance gamma model. In other words, what I'm saying is that it's something that is not easy to understand, because it is required at least to have studied statistics at the university to keep the probability distribution. Secondarily, it suffers the model risk. And so, in other words, even if you are a statistical investor, you could receive different pictures for the same products. So this proposal that actually could be, seems to be the more intuitive and the perfect solution. I give you all the information that I have. Actually, in our opinion, in my opinion, is not the perfect one according to the target that we want to reach. That is just to give you some more information with respect to the price that unfortunately is the wrong one. A second proposal can be just to unbundle the information content of the price. You know, the price is a weighted average, but that weighted average is just the synthesis through the fundamental theorem of asset pricing of all the possible trajectories of the product. So I can use a swap decomposition techniques in order to segregate the risky component from the non-risky component in this price. What I mean? Exactly what is represented here in the slide. So I create the risk-free component, in other words, the overnight index swap term structure, simulation. The overnight index swap is that swap that creates over time the interest rate of an overnight contract. You know what is an overnight contract? I give you some money, you give me the money back the day after with an interest that is predefined. Obviously, I can engineer the overnight contract over 30 years. It's just a question that, I bundle the overnight in order to go in the tomorrow next, and so on. It's a swap, the kind of derivatives that allow you to make this game. So I create the probability distribution of the overnight interest rate over time, and I know the probability distribution of the product. So I can compare these two probability distributions in order to define this decomposition. How to do this? I just create a synthetic swap that sum to the fair value, to the probability distribution of the overnight index swap. So in other words, of the risk-free floater product, gives me back the complex product. By using this technique, I can then, by discounting the positive or the negative leg of the swap, is the same, because the swap worth zero. And so I can use the positive or the negative side of the swap in order, once discounted, to compute the risky component. So in other words, the fair value of the product now is composed by the theoretical value of the risk component, and by subtracting the fair value with respect of the risky component, I know what is the non-risky component. The picture changes for our product. Obviously, now I focus on the three complex products and get rid of considering the low-risk bond for the sake of this class, of this lecture. And you can understand that the theoretical value of the risk-free component, for example, for the defaultable bond in 91, 5 is the risky component. You understand that the PPA product has a 6 in terms of 6.4, the risky component, and it's not a surprise that for the index-linked certificate, the risky component is 9.9. So actually, yes, the index-linked certificate in average was giving you the highest return, but has actually the higher risk in terms of the unbundle of the fair value. As you can see, I have engineered the structure of these products in order to have the same fair value and more or less the same, you know, selling cost, distribution cost. This proposal is a good proposal since it is easy to understand, because you know, I tell you something about the riskiness of the product in a clear way. You invest 100 and 9 euro of these 100 are for a risky component. Unfortunately, this information does not capture the feature of the probability distribution, all the features. It's just a decomposition of the fair value. So we are taking all the possible information that we can from the first moment, but we are still not working on the full picture of the probability. So it's an important step beyond, but it does not fix my original goal, that is to convey the probability distribution to the investor in an understandable way. So I find another proposal, I show another proposal that actually, in our opinion, is the possible solution. But why not to perform a reduction in granularity by implementing a partition of the probability distribution? So in other words, I take the full picture of the probability distribution and I just say, this is the VPPI product. I will give you the two main information: when you win and when you lose, in terms of probability and in terms of the conditional expectation of that event. I can use two partitions. I can use three partitions, as you can see, the red, the blue, and the green one, by using the risk-free asset as a point of reference. Or I can use also, for example, in this case with three partitions, you will realize that for the index-linked certificate, the outcome at the expiry date is negative with 18.9% probability, and you will receive back 49 euros when you have invested 100 euros. Or the outcome is neutral because you will receive after 5 years 120 euros, but with a 68% probability. Or the outcome is really satisfactory because with the 12% probability you will receive 130. Why the second event is neutral? Because actually, in 5 years from now, if I give 100 and I receive 120, it means 5 euro per year. This simulation actually was conducted in another period, not now that the interest rate is negative or close to zero. This is a simulation conducted actually near 2002-2003. It is clear that, okay, I receive 5 euro per year. So it's actually that I leave this money, you know, in a treasury. So in other words, by using the risk-free asset as a benchmark, analyze the risk-free asset always in terms of probability distribution, I say the outcome is neutral because it's the same of a risk-free investment. But if I lose money, it's negative. If I gain money, more than the risk-free asset is satisfactory. Actually, these are obviously the information, the conditional expectation formula that you see in these mean values boxes. It is clear that this information is something that you can understand. Because it's a similar to the information of the first moment that usually is typically given to the investor. Look, if you give me 100 euro, I will give you 120 euro in average. But in this case, I give you a small piece of information that gives you the picture of the distribution, the kind of picture of the distribution. Because I tell you, look, with more or less 20% probability, you lose half of your investment. With a more or less 10% of probability, you receive 30 euro. With the 68, so 70% of probability, you will receive 20 euro more with respect to your investment. So you still have you know, absolute value information that is something that you like, but you receive also the probability information of this you know, average possible result at the expiry date. You can explore also more information, you can increase the partition of the probability distribution, for example, by making 4 partitions. The final value is lower than the issue price, the final value is lower than that of the risk-free asset, is in line with the risk-free asset, or is above the risk-free asset. So in other words, I decompose the neutral scenario within 2 more scenarios. It's not something very useful, but gives you, you know, if you want to go in more detail about this piece of information of the neutral scenario, you can increase the partition. Because, you know, you have a probability distribution. It depends on, you can partition also by taking, you know, all the quantiles. Or you can reduce the granularity, take just 2 events, positive, negative, positive, neutral, negative, or this kind of partition. And then, obviously, the table of the probabilistic performance scenarios becomes a partition within 4 events instead of 3 events, as we have seen before. Benefits of this solution. You know, the reduction in granularity gives you a plenty of information. Is easy to read, is something that you are used to work. And the picture is quite easy to understand. So you will realize immediately the feature of all these products. And for example, you can understand that the BPPI, yes, has a higher probability of losing money, 36.9% probability, but you can just lose 4 euros. Because this, you know, protection technique in the financial engineering of the product that would balance the equity and the bond component and the risk-free component in order to avoid big losses is a sort of insurance. But if you compare the defaultable bond and the index-linked certificate, you would immediately realize that the index-linked certificate is more efficient with respect to the defaultable bond. Because you have more or less double the probability of negative return, and in the positive side of the distribution, it's not a huge difference. So you are in the condition to realize, for example, that some products, even if they have the same price, they are not efficient. It's a typical example of how financial engineering is able to give, you know, more values with respect to a simple product, in a certain sense. But in any case, this regards your investment attitude, because maybe that you want to gain this positive skewness on the product, and you want to undertake the higher negative risk. It depends on your investment attitude, your risk appetite. But without this piece of information, what you will do? Definitely you will take the wrong decision with respect to your risk appetite and investment attitude. What is also more important is something very well known in quantitative finance. This solution is not model risk dependent. This is quite an obvious consideration. If you reduce the granularity, you aggregate events, it is clear that the model risk disappears. In fact, by making the same exercise that we've done before, when under the first proposal I want to convey the full probability distribution, you will realize that, for example, yes, I have the Allwhite probability distribution representation, the Koxinger's or Ross, and you will see that the difference within each box of the probability scenarios in terms of probability is less than 2%. So for a retail investor, is relevant a difference of 2% probability? No. So it's a negligible difference that, in a certain sense, show you that this solution, this is also for the BPPI, the difference is less than 2%. Also for the index linked certificate is less than 4%, so nothing really relevant. We can say that this solution is able to convey the information about the statistical properties of the product, and is understandable and does not suffer from the model risk. A common observation to this approach is actually a false observation, my opinion is, and I will explain you why. Yes, but we have to speak about and discuss and think about probability. This is a complex thing for our brain. I don't want to recall what Kahneman, Nobel Prize in behavioral finances, taught us, that we live with probability. In every moment, we take decision by computing probability. Also in this moment, when I decide the rhythm of my class, I have to compute the probability that you will understand what I'm saying. And I'm looking at your faces in order to understand if I am too fast or too slow, and so I'm computing probability of understanding in this case, you know. And it's not the case, and I like a lot this slide, that in Hollywood, you know, movies, there are some citations, they use probability when they want to convey something in a very quick way. The famous citation from Terminator 2. Based on your pupil dilatation, skin temperature, and motor functions, calculate an 83% probability that you will not pull the trigger. And so on. And also the Divine Comedy, Dante Alighieri, used probability in order to convey information. Because it's something very familiar with us. We are not too confused. The fact that you have to be a quant in order to compute probability, and the fact that you have not to be a quant in order to understand probability. But since, you know, lobbies does not want a similar approach, because this approach discloses risks and discloses implicit costs and discloses what products are good or bad, and increase efficiency in the markets and reduce profits, it is clear that they want to confuse these two dimensions in order to stop a similar approach that is nothing more than the application of the Akerlof-Stiglitz-Lemon's theory. Tell me that this is a lemon in order that they can decide if to buy or not. This is nothing more than that. This is the full picture. Actually, I wrote several years ago also a book with risk books in order to explain all these pieces of the theory and their implementation. And let me just show you that the example that we have said before. So we have three products, the same price. Our investors does not know how to proceed, but the fundamental theorem of asset pricing application creates the probability distribution. And with this representation, the investors are able to take an informed decision and to decide what product is efficient and coherent with his risk appetite. Also, Sole 24 Ore, every Saturday, in a piece that is called Facciamo Trasparenza, in other words, give transparency to products, use this approach that was developed in Consob at the end of the 90s, more or less, in order to disclose the risks of the product. They have also defined a very nice, graphical representation. For example, this is a structured bond, and they tell you that we have negative results with the red light. It's a sort of traffic light approach. You know, red light that tells you that the 17% probability of receiving 23 at the expiry date over 100 invested, nothing is neutral, and 83% of having a good result that gives you back 107 euro with respect to 100 invested. This is something that has been published more or less 3 weeks ago, and it is clear that we have zero, rate to receive in 3 years, 4 years from now. 7 euro is a good investment in this moment. So I believe that this proposal is coherent with the financial theory. Gives you the information that banks compute for their proprietary activity, is easy to understand, and completely represents the statistical feature of the product. Let me give you also some piece of information about the convertibility risk. In year 2012, I wrote a research that actually was discussed in the academy and also within the institution, that the negative interest rate of the bond and the spread of the BTP with respect to the bond actually was representing, yes, the credit risk, that is the typical representation, but actually this information was representing the convertibility risk. In other words, the fact that in case of a euro breakup or a default event for a big country such as Italy, that obviously would determine the euro breakup, because we are not Greece, this information analyzed through the fundamental theorem of asset pricing would represent the fact that the negative rate for the bond, you will receive back mark that was worth more than the original euro. And the spread for the BTP, exactly the other way around, that you will receive lire that was worth less than the original euro. Now is the general theory. What I wrote in this book, The Incomplete Currency, near the book that I wrote with Wale, several years ago, now is a general common theory. At that time, it was disturbing more or less the general consideration of the time. But why I arrived at this conclusion? exactly by applying the fundamental theorem of a surprise. Because you see, this is a typical Bund probability distribution representation. The negative rate is something that is not known in financial mathematics. Why you have a negative rate? The negative rate is the internal rate of return that solves the optimization problem, you know, between the expiry date probability distribution and the fair value at the present fair value. The only way that you can have negative rate is that this is the first part of the distribution, is you will receive your money back plus the coupon. But there is also a piece of distribution where you receive more money than the coupon of that bond. But how can you receive more money from a bond that has a fixed interest rate coupon? Because actually there is an event in which the euro would break up, the Germany would have to create the new mark, and the new mark will worth more than the euro. And so by keeping your portfolio a bond, in other words, you have more money than what the bond would represent. Because in this moment the Bund is denominated in euro, but 3 years from now could be redenominated in mark that would worth more than the euro.
So, Professor, the right yes. side reflects the probability that the euro broke up and...
That is a good point. It's not exactly there because you have to compute composed probability between the different countries. I wrote a piece for Risk Magazine that was published in year 2014, where I compute by using some metrics the euro breakup probability computed implicitly computed by the market through the spread. Exactly this. But if I show you the picture, for example, for Italy, this is the fact that you will receive back less money, the default. But remember, a country like Italy, it's not the case that they would default and give you back 40 euro. The default would probably define the event of redenomination risk. In other words, I decide to exit from the euro. I would create the new lira with an exchange rate 1-to-1 with the old euro. The forex market would devaluate the lira and you would receive less money back. This is not a deterministic analysis. Obviously, this is a probabilistic analysis. But this is the decomposition of what financial markets quotes with the spread and with the negative rate. I just opened the picture by using the fundamental theorem of asset pricing. And as the guy in the back in the last line was arguing, it is clear that by using spread information, I can compute also the probability of the euro breakup. Because if I take the Spanish spread, the French spread, the German negative rate, the Italian spread, and by composing these marginal probability distribution with some proper techniques, I can argue what the financial markets think about the euro surviving in the next year, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, etc. So you're not too surprised that at the end of year 2012, the governor of the Bank of England declared, we are ready for the B plan and for the euro breakup. Because at that time, by making this computation, we were very close to the euro breakup. The probability was above 60%, implicit in the spread, quoted for the euro member states. obviously, at that time, when I wrote this piece and also the piece of Euro Breakup, you can imagine that the institution of the Euro bureaucracy does not like a similar disclosure of the problem. They were aware about the problem, but obviously there is a, you know, quite a strange attitude that it's better than you don't speak and discuss about some topics. It's a general attitude. Actually, I think exactly the other way around. It's better to share in a technical and objective way the considerations and what is happening in order that you can identify the better policy. And also you can allow maybe to a, you know, an austerity policy or something that is different, to difficult to digest for people, for citizens. But if you know that a problem is there, maybe that you can understand what is going on. And this is the problem of the financial education. It's exactly the other way around. If you don't, in this moment, also the debate on this topic, in my opinion, is wrong. You cannot speak about financial education if the risks are not disclosed in a comprehensible way. What is financial education without knowing risks? If I don't tell you that the spread actually represents something pathological for the euro architecture, because the spread is not only the credit risk of the country, but is also the euro breakup event, embeds some information. But if we speak, if the financial markets speak about the euro breakup, it means that some policy has to put into action to avoid this event. So it's not a question of tells to citizens you want or you don't want the euro. That is completely wrong attitude, because you speak to the stomach of people that they not understood what is going on and what is happening. The point is another. If financial markets are quoting the euro breakup event, and we believe that the euro is a good thing and we have to invest in it, it means that we have to find new policies and change the policy in order to avoid the financial markets quote this event. Because there is not a tax in the financial markets. This is another false information. Banks, hedge funds, and institutional investors want to make money. That's it. And so they bet in order to make money. If the policy would tell to the market, we believe in the euro and we start, for example, an extraordinary policy intervention that would state zero spread within the eurozone, believe me, all of the institutional investors would start to bet on this. It already happened. At the end of the, in 3 years, at the end of the 90s, with something that is now well known in literature as convergency trades, the financial institution starts with some arbitrage transaction between, for example, the Italian Treasury and the German Bund, in order to have one unique interest rate structure. Because the financial European institution was very clear, in year 2000 the euro would start. And for the European Central Bank, all the govies, in other words, the Eurozone membership treasuries, are equal in terms of risk, in terms of as if used as collateral in repos transaction, in terms of Basel Solvency II and UCITS prudential regulation. So the message to institutional investors was clear. We intend to create a currency as we used to study in the political economy book in the first year of economy at the in the faculty of the university. One currency, one unique term structure. So, if you would be an hedge fund, obviously,
since the interest rate of the BTP was higher with respect to the bond, you will start arbitrage. Because since there is a negative relationship between price and interest rate, obviously you can gain money, because you know that by selling the bond, you bring the return up. By buying the BTP, you bring the interest rate down. And since you know that within these new rules of the euro area, the BTP and the bond will be treated equal, it is clear that you can gain easy money. In this moment, since instead all the policies that has been put into action after the crisis, year 2008, are in the sense that the spread is something physiological, it is normal that every country has to play on its own the problems. If you would be an hedge fund, on what you will bet? On the divergence of the economic cycle. And so they are acting and making money with another kind of arbitrage, the divergence trade. They bet on the spread. They make arbitrage on the quantitative easing because they know that the European Central Bank, through the National Central Bank, would buy govies by using the capital key. And so they know how to make money and make arbitrage, because they know what will be the heart of the National Central Bank on the govies market. What I want to say is that, by summarizing our consideration here, is that if we don't realize that any time you have a different price, return, and probability distribution, the market is quoting some event, in this simple classic day, the outcome is negative, is neutral, is satisfactory. Or we believe 5 years from now that there is a 5% probability that we will have a new mark. We will have a 10-15% probability that in 5 years we will have new lire with respect to euro. So the force of the fundamental theorem of asset pricing is that it is able to disclose you the events and the corresponding probability that the market is quoting. Okay, but I hope that you enjoy at least the class. And obviously I thank Domenico. The slides will be definitely...
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Marcello. Thank you.